This presentation is brought to you by the Zach Ross Foundation, a global philanthropic organization with a focus on poverty, education, and mental health.
Psychologically induced consciousness, sensory deprivation, hypnosis, meditation. Anybody ever been hypnotized? No? Probably, you ever been hypnotized just by in dealing with others? Hey, have you ever been in love?
Yeah.
Right? Early stages, what you call maybe the honeymoon phase of falling in love with somebody, infatuation, right? Infatuated with this person. There's been studies to show that that's a form of hypnosis, right? You're hypnotized by words, things that people say to you, how good they make you feel. Wow, he makes me feel good, she makes me feel wonderful, right? You feel euphoric. That's a form of hypnosis, but there are actually real forms. Once you're in those states, you can recall certain memories that you may not have had in quite a long time. People recall things from very early stages of life. Psychologists do practice that. They practice hypnosis to try to gather information from your past in order to understand it and help you out with what's going on in your present. Meditation. Anyone here meditate? Let's say prayer can be a form of meditation, right? So if we are praying, we may be in a conscious state of mind where we're trying to relax ourselves, focus our attentions on maybe a spiritual level, right? In order to objectively create some sort of power out of that. Right? So that's an altered state of consciousness. You know, once your room is quiet, you may put on some background music or something like that, some instrumental. Or you may just be in complete silence. The CIA uses tactics, right, to torture people. Other governments use them as well, too. And they use these to extract information from people, right, who are trained not to give information. They're trained for to be tortured if captured, right? The worst form, probably noticed, in order to extract information from the captured individual, is sleep deprivation. Right? It's not waterboarding, it's not pulling out your toenails, pulling out your fingernails, or driving nails through your feet, which are just physically painful. But typically, the form that works the most is sleep deprivation. If you keep somebody from falling asleep, eventually, unwillingly, their consciousness begins to alter. At that point, the body goes into just survival mode, regardless of what that person's thinking you can extract the information that way. So to be deprived of sleep is very effective to altering the mind, altering your consciousness. That's why it's so important to get a good night's rest. Like you lose two or three hours, the rest of your day is done, because you can't even properly think. You can't probably be aware of what's going on. In psychology, we have cognitive neuroscience, right? Which is an interdisciplinary study of brain activity with mental processes. So here we learn that consciousness arises from synchronized activity across the brain. Synchronized. Various things are happening and communicating in the brain with each other to create consciousness. Here, this individual looks like they had some form of head trauma. You see that there's very limited points that are synchronizing together. Right? With the healthy volunteers, let's say down here, you have a multitude, sort of a greater amount of neural activity happening that's communicating, right? Top of your brain, the back. Your cortex, all communicating one to the other. So people who suffer brain trauma, it can limit their state of consciousness. They can no longer be aware of self. They no longer could be aware that they're hungry. No longer could be aware that they may need a bath. Right? They're no longer aware of things happening with themselves and other environments. So we have selective attention, which is conscious awareness focused on a particular stimulus. Gives an example of a cocktail party effect. Right? You go to a party, there's a lot of people you have to engage with, a lot of things going on, a lot of chatter. Let's say you meet your best friend, and now you're just trying to focus on giving them attention and talking to them without looking at all the other stimulus happening out there. So we select by priority. You know, what is the value to you? What is the priority to you right at this very moment? That's where your attention is. So selective attention and accident. So rapid switching between activity for very sustained focused attention, such as using mobile phones while driving, right? Increases your risk for traffic accidents. How many people here text while driving? I'm pretty sure everybody does that, because I do it too. You know, you're trying to reply back, you're focusing on attention, maybe somebody's, you know, you got a notification that's important, something funny on the internet, something like that. But think of that concept. We actually are putting our lives in danger, our physical lives in danger. Because we can't pay attention for that one. We can't just focus on driving and staying on the road. We have selective attention. Things are constantly changing priorities. Oh, now I'm just texting. I'm going back to my long driving, 80 miles an hour on the highway. So the brain is constantly selecting priority in terms of what we pay attention to at a particular time. Studies have shown that even talking with passengers, say for like Uber drivers or taxi drivers, that talking with drivers increases the risk of accidents. Okay. So it doesn't have to be visual communications like seeing something on your phone. You can also be just talking to somebody in your car. Because we have automated emotions, if somebody says a particular thing, we feel the need to kind of look at them, glance at them. Turn our body first, in which case we'll put our lives at risk too. In its intentional blindness, failing to see visible objects when attention is directed elsewhere. Anybody can give an example of that? Failing to see visible objects when attention is directed elsewhere. We could still use their driving example, right? You know, you made an accident, Jessica, right? And now you need to see how bad it was. First thing in your mind, man, how bad was this accident? Second thing in mind, I should record it as I drive past and post it on the internet. And we completely ignore the entire environment of, oh, we're still driving. We're still driving. Change blindness is failing to notice changes in the environment. What are some examples of that? Anybody? When you fail to notice changes in the environment, your immediate environment. Right, we could say, same vehicle to circle this block for the third time. Right? While on a group, one person notices it. The other remainder of the group, looking at the same direction, doesn't notice it. Yes.
Can you ask the question one more time?
Changes in your environment, right? When you don't notice changes in your environment, even though it's right there in front of you, your face, right? This happens a lot. I was asking, what were some examples?
I mean, some people are more, they know that they pay attention to the little details, and more people should pay attention to the bigger picture. But like, they're not allowing themselves or their mind to actually look at the little things that allow that bigger picture to be present.
Yeah, so someone could be more detail oriented. But hey, did you notice that spider right there? You're like, what spider? Like, that one right there. You're like, oh wow, I didn't even see that. What were you gonna say?
So, like, I got here late because I was on my phone while my dad was driving, and he was like taking me to work instead of school. So maybe that could be an example, because instead of like telling him, like, you know, you just passed like a bus or whatever, he like was like driving me to work.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a change in your environment. Anybody know? Yes, sir.
Maybe another example I'd be using this is like someone that constantly goes hiking. They notice little things and paths. They notice the sounds of nature, they notice like beehives, they notice bugs around. Where if you take someone that doesn't usually hike, they won't pay attention to the little things, they'll just go through the path and not even look around themselves.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like, oh man, the trees change, right? Right, these were pine trees back here, right? Now we're coming up, there's oak trees here. Yeah. Now we're first back up, and now it's just trees and things. Dual processing and two-track mind. So we kind of alluded to that earlier in the class. Having a two-track mind. Not necessarily, right? Good argument. Might not be that we actually have two minds. Right? A mind is an abstract thing. The brain is a physical thing. Mind. Mentality is an abstract thing. But we still can try to do our best to define these things. So dual processing, simultaneous information processing on separate conscious and unconscious tracks. So you have conscious and unconscious happening at the same time. This is a constant fluid motion of awareness and unawareness. There's some things you're gonna do right now that are just maybe it's unaware. Right? You might pay attention and go look up something on the internet. Why? You're unaware, it's just part of your habit. You've been doing it for so long, that's what you're going to continue to do. Now, other things you're very conscious of. You're like, hey, I forgot about that one thing I meant to do there. I'm not sure. feel that, like, in today's society, everyone is quote-unquote going woke?
Quote-unquote going what?
Woke. Right? Everybody's going woke. Everybody's becoming quote-unquote very aware, very conscious. Do we see that as a trend? Everyone's feeling like they're more conscious than they were?
I want to say a trend. I think people are just becoming more aware that they can't just believe what's going on social media, news. People take the responsibility to actually research and understand what's going on.
So now we have a lot of information, right?
Yeah.
We take all this information and try to make better judgments than before.
I mean, it's easy to be a sheep and just follow everybody else. It's another to get out of that pathway and that kind of mindset and become your own person and engage in what you want to learn.
Yeah, absolutely. But and that works both ways, right? When we say, even if we do find out certain information, we may have some sort of like cognitive dissonance to it. You know, like if we find particular facts, but we already believed in something prior, we might not believe that even though there's facts. Do we see that happening too? That people are actually going against facts? Or that facts don't matter anymore?
Yeah.
Where do you think that's coming from? How come facts don't matter anymore?
Because of their personal beliefs. Like earlier, there was like I was like reading an argument on Facebook about like it was like trans women aren't women or whatever, and then there was this guy who was like he disagreed with it or whatever, and he was like this girl literally proved everything, like he like brought psychology, so like sociology, everything into it. He was like, I don't care, the Bible says like whatever. So it's like his personal belief against like actual facts.
Which. Yes, sir.
I mean, it also comes down to like how people grew up. Like what I've noticed is that older people don't like to be told otherwise.
Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe we just become also more individualistic, which means that my facts are just my facts. I don't care about the world's facts or anybody else's. Right? Because I made up my own facts. Blue is red, red is blue, because I said so. Which shows sort of the negative part of the internet, right? Maybe we have too much. There could be too much information, right? Some people might argue that, hey, not enough information is a bad thing, which is true. But maybe too much information is also a bad thing. But at some point, the brain can never process what is real and what is not real. We're overloaded with information. Someone can say, hey, I quoted this article. Someone said, hey, I found this article that conflicts that article. Okay? And a lot of times we're just lazy. We're going to take what the sources we already believe and make that a fact. We're only going to look at one thing. Nobody wants to go keep looking to fact check to look up 30 different sources. So too much information may distort entire population's consciousness. We can't even decide what's real or fake anymore. And some people say, well, I'll decide what's real and what's fake. I'll make my own facts. We don't believe in each other anymore. Maybe not that we did before anyway, but we believe in each other less. So yeah, conscious and unconscious, track-minded people. That's what human beings are. We are consciously doing unconscious things, and we are very conscious as well to what's going on in our environment, in our world. People familiar with circadian rhythm, what that is? Anybody know what circadian rhythm is? Like your natural sleep cycle. The human body is made to sleep at night, wake in the day, the cycle. Okay. Some people are, how many of you guys like to stay up late at night, go to sleep 2-3 in the morning? Why is that? For you particularly.
For me?
Do you do your best thinking at night or something, or why do you stay up late?
I just think I do too much during the day for my brain. Like, I get really tired throughout the day, but when the night comes through, like, I really don't get tired. I wake up, and it's hard for me to fall asleep. With that being said, like, I usually just stay up and do extra work, get ahead of class. So yeah, like, I do think, just due to the simple fact that I do my work at night instead of during the day. But during the day, I usually start my day at 7 in the morning with lifts, then go to work, and then from work, go to class, and then from the class, go to practice.
So requirements of your life dictate your sleeping pattern.
Yeah.
Right? Things that you gotta get done. If you had no requirements, you think you would go sleep earlier? If you didn't have those responsibilities?
100%. If I didn't have any real responsibilities, I'd be better now.
Me too. Circadian rhythm, internal biological clock. We all have this. We all have the internal biological clock. But there's two biological rhythms. 24-hour biological clock, which is circadian, and the 90-minute sleep cycle. Typically, if you fall asleep, on average, every 90 minutes, you'll enter a different phase of sleeping. Okay? Sleep where you just, you hear something real subtle in the room, you jump up. Why? You're like, ah, you know, I was asleep, but I wasn't in a deep sleep. There's sleep where you are dreaming within dreams. You have a dream within a dream. You're deeply asleep. You can hear anything of it, even if they were shooting outside. And we'll address those different phases. These get altered by age and experience. Typically, we'll say older people go to sleep earlier, 8 p.m., 9 p.m. You can't call them past, they say they're calling past 9 or 10 o'clock. You sleep or learn better. And experience as well, too, which is we recognize that our bodies may need sleep, so we're going to give it the sleep we need. You may recognize that we need naps during the day, and we're going to take a nap. We talked about night owls versus the morning type. How many people here wake up 4 o'clock in the morning? 5 o'clock in the morning? 6 o'clock in the morning? 6? Oh, you don't get much sleep?
No.
You say 6? 7 o'clock in the morning. Hey, you get up at 7. Hey. 8 o'clock in the morning. How many people wish they could get up at 11 o'clock? First of all. Okay, there you go. Right? We all wish we could sleep in as late as we possibly can. But it really just is what works best for you and how you think your body feels so that you're the most productive during the day. I know I'm most productive during the night. I stay awake till like 2. When I was younger, it's probably till like 3. I just felt like I did my best thinking late at night. Like even drinking coffee. And so back to these different phases and patterns of sleeping. Okay. Looking at the MG here, we get left eye movements that happen during sleep, right eye movements that happen during sleep. They vary, they differ. Right and left differ from movement. Muscle tension in our lips and underneath our chin. Right? And different brain waves are occurring, different parts of our brain are activated while sleeping. Right? We may be still conscious of certain things happening, but very unconscious about other things. Is that every 90 minutes, people cycle through distinct sleeping stages? Right? REM, do we know what REM means? What?
Rapid eye movement.
Yeah, and left and right eye movement, what's going on, what's occurring. We can assess what different phase of sleep you're in. Let's say REM1 sleep, slow breathing, irregular brainwaves, hallucinations, hypnagogic sensations, different beliefs. Phase two, you relax more deeply. Right? 20 minutes in, sleep spindles at ACE memory processing. You start thinking about old things, old memories. Right? You're conscious, you're going towards more dreaming phase. Right? Typically, you're thinking about immediate memories. Like, oh man, I'm trying to go out and have some last week. That's crazy. And you'll mix in other things that happened today, mix in other things that happened 2 weeks ago, mix in some things that happened years ago. Deep sleep lasts for about 30 minutes, slow delta waves occur. Brain is moving slower and slower. Doesn't talk about rapid sawtooth brain waves, heart rate rise, rapid and irregular breathing, darting eyes. That happens in that rapid eye movement sleep. A lot is going on at that point in your brain. You have a burst of activity happening. Some people say when they wake up, you know, they may have had an arousal accident happen, you know. They're having quote unquote a wet dream. Active motor cortex messages blocked by brainstem, which can cause arousal. Some people experience sleep paralysis at that stage, right? The final stage of sleep. You guys ever had sleep paralysis? Where you feel like you can't move? Were you afraid when that happened?
Like the first few times, yeah.
How did you get out of it? What were you thinking?
I just tried to move.
Huh?
I just tried to move.
You just tried to move, right? So then you say you're conscious and consciously unconscious, right? You're like, oh man, I can't move. Well, how are you even thinking that if you're asleep? Right? Wasn't interesting for that. Dreams within dreams. But hey, something frightful is happening in the dream, I need to get out of it. I mean, you get out of it, but you might just go again. That is the secondary part you need to get out of. You guys ever dream that you are falling? You know? Yeah, those are probably some of the worst. Because, like, you can physically, you know, you really feel like your body is a ton of gold. So just looking at the rhythms of sleeping, and we see a lot of activity that is kind of more spread out. And it kind of gets this more solemn activity, but you still see these jumps, things are happening in your dreams. And so. Well, in here, let's just go through this really quick. What affects our sleep patterns? Genetic influence, cultural influences. Some cultures sleep more than others, right? Some culture looks towards more productivity. It doesn't really look at sleep that much, right? More sleep is by prior culture. Affects your presence, absence of light. Do you sleep with the lamp on? Do you sleep with the room light on? Do you sleep with it on? Does that affect your sleep? We have light sensitive retinal protein, which means that we probably should sleep with the light on. If you don't recognize that you're actually having your body rest with the light on, and improve your productivity the next day. There's a chronic state of desynchronization amongst night shift workers. Desynchronization, meaning the brain is synthesized, right? Between conscious and unconscious. people who work overnight, hey, I work at UTS, hey, I work at FedEx, so, hey, I work here overnight. Typically, you'll see a lot of bad side effects in terms of thinking mode, consciousness, for those who work overnight as opposed to those who just work during the day. If you work overnight, keep that in mind. It may be something you need to change over time that may impact your quality of life. All right, any questions before we go? No? All right, I'll see you in a minute. I'll upload that stuff probably tomorrow.
This presentation was brought to you by the Zach Ross Foundation, a global philanthropic organization focusing on poverty, education, and mental health. We hope you've enjoyed.